Now we're coming to the last talk. Professor Gerd Storm, he is already known in our community very well. He is from Institute of Pharmaceutical Science in Utrecht University, and you're talking about intravenous application of liposomal particles for atherosclerosis.
Gerd. Hello, good morning. Most of you, not all of you, but many of you, I should say, know me from nanopharmaceuticals for drug targeting. That has been my central research theme all my research life. And from the Utrecht University and the last decade also under the umbrella of the University of Twente, but in particularly with Dan Krommelin and Wim Hennink. But we all retired. And actually, I'm now talking more on behalf of the NUS, the National University of Singapore, because one day after my retirement, I started to work in Singapore. And actually, for the talk today with the title, but I embedded it a little bit, what are we doing in Asia, in Singapore, with nanomedicine? And why am I there? Maybe the first question should be, how do you end up in Singapore? Always being in Utrecht, in the Netherlands, in Europe, and maybe America, and now I'm in Singapore. Now, this is a very simple answer. That is networking, collaboration. And over the last decade, I had quite some collaborations with groups in Singapore. For instance, with the hospital, the ophthalmology hospital, the eye hospital, the SNEC hospital in Singapore. And the first author of this paper is an ophthalmologist, but he was a PhD student in Utrecht. So, and the last author was his professor, Professor Tina Wong, also ophthalmology. And we came up in the thesis with this paper in which we studied subconjunctival injection of liposomal corticosteroids for the treatment of ocular inflammation. Well, in this case, it was in a rabbit model of experimental uveitis, and we saw very strong anti-inflammatory activity and also long-lasting anti-activity. So, and actually all this work led to a company in Singapore. It's Eden Ophthalmic, and we were active in the clinic. And one of the primary things we have obtained so far is that, if you have ocular inflammation, and that happens a lot in the eye hospitals, but in patients, of course, after surgery in the hospital, retinal surgery, cornea surgery, cataract surgery, and after surgery, the patients go home, but they have to use eye drops for a long time, some of them, even 3-4 times per day, and then for 4 to 6 weeks. And we found that, this is an example of a patient. If you take out the old lens and you replace it with the new lens, now the patient is ending up with inflammation because of the operation. But if you give one subconjunctival injection of the liposomes, corticosteroid liposomes, then over time you actually don't see any inflammation anymore. You do not need the eye drops anymore. It is done at the time of the operation, before the patient leaves the operation room. So one single dose. And it's actually also outside the eye. Eh? Subconjunctival is just outside the eye. So it's very remarkable effect. This led to the company with the right person at the top is the PhD student, but he's now an ophthalmologist, he has a private clinic, and Professor Tina Wong still there. Bart Metzeler was involved at this, this already some years ago, and he's well known for his industrial development of liposomal corticosteroids. Anyway, that was a collaboration ongoing in the last decade. Another collaboration was with the NUS, and in particular with the School of Medicine, so the NUH, the National University Hospital in Singapore. And this is the group I've been working with. I cannot, is there a pointer? No, as always. And there is a lady in the green shirt. It's Yen Chong. In the middle, there is Zhongwei Wang, there is Niloufer Sayed, there is Sitong Sang, and there are many others we have been collaborating with. And at the right, you see my technician, Louis van Blois. He sent many formulations, liposome formulations, to Singapore, because this was a collaboration with Utrecht University primarily. And this ended up in some nice projects, which are still ongoing. And one of these projects is and this is actually the article, came out in Journal of Controlled Release very recently in August, is with Suet Gen Wang, Jen Chong. And the last author is Zhongwei Wang. And what we did is studying the intravenous administration of DHA incorporated in liposomes. And why were we interested in doing that? Zhongwei Wang is actually very active in the field of cardiovascular nanomedicine. And this was for me a leftover from the Nano Atero project. Maybe you remember. We were together. Actually, I know you from, I think, from the Nano Atero project first, before CleanAm even. So, we were focused in the left corner. You see there these plaques. So inflamed arteries, and if these plaques rupture, then you are in a big problem. And that was the focus in a Nano Etero project. It was an EU project, and but finished already quite some years ago. But if you have these things, you would like to keep, of course, your plaque stable. And if rupture occurs, you have terrible events like heart attacks and stroke. So to keep them stable, there is this concept that the plaque is inflamed. So if you deliver anti-inflammatory drugs to the plaque, then maybe you could keep the plaque stable and the fibrous cap stable, and that would be good for patients at risk for cardiovascular events. And actually with Willem Mulder, I don't know if he's in the room, but he's in the meeting, we did a liposomal corticosteroids in the clinic, but also we're interested in applying DHA for that purpose. Why? Because DHA, it is known that people from Greenland that they have hardly any myocardial infarction. And why? The idea is that they eat a lot of tuna, they eat a lot of salmon, and this is, of course, rich in polyunsaturated fatty acids. We are not doing that so much, but we have now the DHA capsules. And DHA capsules are recommended by doctors to patients at risk for cardiovascular events to eat them, because of this correlation. And there have been some clinical studies. These people have been eating these DHA capsules and with different compositions, with similar doses. But in one study, the strength study, they really see that there is, in the second study, the vital study, that there is a reduction in heart attacks, 28%. Not in other events. But in the first studies, there was no significant difference in major adverse cardiac events and between control and treatment. So is it useful to use DHA capsules if you are at risk for certain events, and particularly a rupture of plaques? That was our question, and we thought, let's put the system at the extreme. Let's not do, because there could be differences in bioavailability. We know also oxidation is ongoing of the DHA in the capsules. Maybe these are all bioavailability problems, absorption problems. So let's put them DHA IV. Now, and we put them, so then you have 100% bioavailability. And secondly, we put them in liposomes, and liposomes are known that they can enter plaques and fire sort of EPR effect, if the plaques are inflamed, and they enter the macrophages in the plaques. So that was our idea. Let's put the system at the extreme. We used two different models, and I'm not going to give details, but the APE model, and we have also the LDR receptor model. But if you look at the right in B, you see if you treat in these models in which plaque formation is ongoing, and in aortic roots primarily focused on, but you can see there aortic roots, you can see there's a lot of plaques with the control liposomes, so empty liposomes, but after treatment with the DHA liposomes, we see much less plaques. It's not completely resolved. And what we also saw that there is less lipid in the plaque, So less foam cells, foam cell macrophages, that's the first row after treatment. We also see there are less macrophages, particularly less M1 macrophages. We also see a polarization towards the M2 type macrophages. Also, what was a little bit unexpected, we saw an increase in collagen synthesis in the plaques. So that would be helpful for the fibrous caps, so to stabilize them. So altogether, you can see at the right, in two different models, altogether you can then, that's is possible, calculate a sort of, an atherosclerotic a vulnerability index, a plaque vulnerability index. We can measure the macrophages, lipids, foam cells, collagen is incurring, so the lipids go down, macrophages go down. Actually, at the level of smooth muscle cells, actin, we don't see any difference. But then you see there is a reduction of this index, meaning a positive effect on the stability of the plaques. So, this all led to our paper with the conclusion there is less pro-inflammatory action in the plaques ongoing in these animals because of less M1 macrophages and less activity of the M1 macrophages, less pro-arteriothrombotic activity because of less foam cell macrophages and more M2 macrophages, which give anti-inflammatory effects and leading to plaque stabilization. Well, a few slides, I have 2 minutes, about Singapore. This was one collaboration, and then they said, oh, you are retiring, let's come to Singapore. So I said, yes, beautiful place to live, very comfortable also. And there's a new center for nanomedicine. And it's the one instrumental person in this is Professor Lee. He works as a surgeon. I work at the Department of Surgery at the hospital. And we have a main mission in this center, clinical translation of nanomedicine. It's a school of medicine. Then, in the left, you see him as Professor Lee. We have a nanostroke program, so particularly devoted to stroke. And particularly the guy in Belong, Matthias Wacker, is a sort of responsible of pulling this project further. Also Georgia Pastorin, they are both from the School of Pharmacy. But we also have a nano-NASH program. And that is against NASH disease. Why? We have a nano-heart program also. So there's certain diseases selected and programs are being set up or already running. This is already running for some years. And of course, fatty liver disease, overeating of bad fats and food, the McDonald's type of diets can lead to this type of things in the morning when you look in the mirror. And but that is not so bad. It's worse maybe with the liver. And it's happening a lot in Singapore. It's about 40% of the people are expected to have some degree of fatty liver disease. And worldwide, it's around 25%. So also here in Basel or in the Netherlands, there's quite a lot of fatty liver disease. And that is maybe not the big problem if you have a fatty liver. It's still benign. But at certain point, the hepatocytes are so filled with fat, they start to swell. And then the immune system, they recognize these hepatocytes. And then the inflammatory cells come in. And you get an inflamed liver. And that's NASH. Can go on for many years. But you have an inflamed liver without knowing. The diagnosis of this is not very well, developed yet. But at a certain point, you have also then fibrosis. Stellate cells are going to be activated, and they secrete collagen. You get a fibrotic liver or cirrhotic liver, and you need transplantation of the liver. And also you can get hepatocellular carcinoma. If you are at these ends, then I think you need a liver transplantation or something, and you are in very worse conditions. Before that, maybe you can reverse. And this is what we do. And actually, there's no drug yet available for NASH treatment. The companies develop many drugs, but they mostly fail at the level of toxicity. And what in the group, and that is Felix, I don't know if he's in the audience, but is a student from Singapore. He's presented a poster on this project in which we have LNPs delivering siRNA to the liver, a fatty liver in a model, in NASH liver, and we are decreasing ceramides in the liver. It's not my intention to present this project. He did already, but we have these ceramides promote fatty liver disease, and actually this is the group, but we can really, you can see, it's just one result. At the left you have this liver filled with fat, oral staining, but after treatment with the siRNA, which is actually silencing the activity of ceramide synthesizing enzymes in the liver, you see much less fat in the liver with these LMPs. Very nice results. We also focus, for instance, on senescent cells in the liver, in the NASH liver, to eliminate the senescent cells. Particularly the last thing, we are also focusing on the hepatocellular carcinoma, and because that is still a very difficult, deadly tumor and very difficult to treat. And we do that actually with a very novel nanomedicine we have developed. And you can see here, this is MRI through the animal, so it's the same animal. So you have PBS treatment, and you see the red circles, the tumor is growing, this is the liver tumor, very fast in 2 weeks. It's a big, bulky tumor in the animal. You can look at it by MRI at different levels in the body. And if you treat with this drug, IU drug, then you see we keep the growth minimal, and actually it's reducing. After a month, we don't see any tumor anymore. This led also to the creation of a new company, and that's a Utrecht company. So the collaboration is back, but it's a spin-off from Utrecht University, and this nanomedicine contains RNA. It's immunotherapy, and it's with the guy who developed this, particularly in his PhD thesis work in Utrecht, Lucas Sentner. A very experienced in liposomal vaccines. He also developed or contributed at GSK to liposomal Sphingrix, which is a product on the market. Anyway, this is my last slide. Retire before you expire. I don't know what the word expire means, but I saw this on the internet. I thought this is a nice way to end this lecture. Thank you so much.